Yo, yo, what up? This is Jacob Sokol, founder of Sensify, and welcome to Quadruple Your Coaching Biz. If you're already a successful coach, but want to take your biz to the next level with more ease, more fun, and more impact, then get ready. This interview is called Getting in Touch with Your Divine Business Manager, and it's with Allison Crow Flanagan. You'll learn more about what that means as we go into the interview, but first, a little bit about Allison. Allison is an intuitive life and business coach who helps her clients, including leaders, coaches, entrepreneurs, artists, and executives. She helps all those people get into alignment with their true selves. She's transitioned from the fast-paced world of performance and sales coaching and is now passionate about helping her clients find the answers already inside of them by being more and doing less. She specializes in the law of attraction coaching, energy alignment, assessing intuition, and courageous, creative, and inspired action. It's a lot of cool words, but let's see what that actually means in today's interview. Some of the things that we'll be exploring are how to create a unique group program that oozes with personality. One of the things that I love about Allison is you can't help but get who she is when you communicate with her. And you'll see that in today's interview. She can't not be her. We'll also go into the details of moving from one-on-one to group programs. Sometimes creating group programs can be tricky, and we've got a bunch of questions about how to actually create a program that astonishes people and is wildly successful. We'll also explore a spiritual practice for calling future clients into your program. This is something that can seem really inspirational and really fun, but what I love here is this is actually a practice that at the end of the interview, you can rock right then. Allison, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
Yeah, well, I'm excited that we get to dive in deeper. It was great to briefly connect at the Prosperous Coach Intensive in London earlier last year. And I'm curious, how long have you been coaching at this point?
In February, it will be the beginning of my ninth full year, starting my 10th year.
Wow, 9 years. And what I'm curious about is, I'm wondering, in that 9 year period of time, was there 1 year that jumps out as you as just being a year where your business grew exponentially?
Exponentially, I don't know if that's the right word, but for the first 4 years, I worked for an international real estate company and I did sales coaching. And I was an independent contractor, so, but I kind of had a pool of agents to work from. And I did really well my first year, and I did really, really well my second year. And then after 4 years of that, I left and started my own. I had 47 clients, and I left with one. And it seems like I have this pattern, like I kind of reinvent myself every 2 years. And the first year is strong, but then the second year is like, woohoo, this is fun. Right. So, I would say almost every 2 years, and I tend to go in these cycles where I get a little bored and I want to create something new. And so the first year is the building year, and then the second year is the exponential. If that makes any sense. And let me say, as far as exponential growth, I'm running my business to fund my life, to fund my feel good. I'm not trying to build something scalable or sellable, or I'm not striving to double my business every year, if that sense it makes sense. I'm working to create a life of ease and joy and time with my husband and painting and intense relationships with my clients. And a little fun on the side, you know, girls gotta have skincare.
Yeah. That's great. So take us to the most recent iteration of that 2 year cycle that you go through.
Yeah, I think it was probably this year. I started on my own, I started in the, like, I was doing the online model kind of thing, and I was doing well at it. I mean, I was still making six figures, but I was working a lot, and I was creating a lot, and I was needing an assistant, and I was spending a lot in my business other than coaching, because I've always spent a lot on coaching. And when I met Rich May a year ago, so it's been about a year and a half, I was pissed when I read The Prosperous Coach. And I sent him a nasty message, and I was like, fuck you, you're right. And he laughed, he got it, you know, that I wasn't really, and I was like, damn it, I read your book and I'm pissed because you're right. And I knew that. And I knew, you know, I knew that it was about relationships and serving, and I forgot. And I got into the machine. And so it was interesting because that March, all my clients, for the first time in all this time, in 7 years of coaching, I had clients fire me. They were falling off. They weren't paying. So my roster cleared out and I just started again. And last year was a building year. I had last year I had my first really strong paying clients. I've always had, you know, around $1,000 a month, but I had a lot stronger paying clients. And then this time last year, I decided, what do I want to create? Like, what do I want to play in? What do I want to coach on? How do I want to do it? What do I want the container to be like? And I decided, and I had done groups before, but I decided I wanted to do a women's circle that I wasn't just the coach, but I was also a member of. I wanted it to be totally authentic. I already crossed the lines with my clients. I tend to become friends with them. We drink together. I know how to wear both those hats kind of thing. And I'm seeing all these amazing people that I work with. And I decided I want them to know each other. And I had done groups before, but I had no clue how powerful it could be. And so last year at this time, I decided, literally, I said, fuck it. I want to go to Tulum. My husband was tired of going to Tulum. So I was like, well, I want to go to Tulum. So I'm going to start in Tulum. And I did a lot of artwork and visioning. I stayed out of my head in the creation of what this would be. And I stuck with what I knew, that it would be seven women, that it would be an energetic container, that we would coach on anything and everything that came up, that we would seek divine sport, that it would be kind of mystical, that we would tap into spirituality and all the woo-woo stuff, as well as the business stuff. And I met these seven women on a beach in Mexico, and I've been doing those circles ever since. I'm on my third one now. And what was exponential about that was I charged more for these groups than I was charging for one-on-one coaching. And that's kind of backwards. Normally you think, oh, you're in a group and it's less than one-on-one coaching. And that those fees are actually indicative of, this is the first time I've done something in a group that's more powerful than the one-on-one coaching. And so I've had quite
Can I jump in here? Because there was like four different points. I'm like, yes, we're going to go there. Nope, now we're going to go there. Nope, here it is. So before you keep, you know, giving me so many places to go, you said something that struck me, which was that you had a process to stay out of your head when you were creating this group. What was that like? Because I think that's one of the things that we can get trapped in, is needing to know all the details and logistics. And so how do you work with that?
You know, it's funny, and I have no reflection, but I, can you see that?
Yeah, hold a little higher, please.
Okay. We'll get that down too. So this is one of my art journals. I don't think it's the one that I created. Maybe it is the one that I created that. But I literally just start playing with color and shapes and ideas. And believe it or not, this is not just like a craft book. This is my business planning and thinking and dreaming. And that's part of my, like, so this was one of my circles, like where I literally start to see the energy of the people. And as I fill the circle, their names go by it. And so, you know, it's not this profound art, but it's what I do to keep in my creative space, in my spirit place, in my heart, and not worry about all the things that, you know, I was taught, that were taught as coaches that we should do. Like I should build this, and I should have this web page and this sales page, and I should know my target audience. I just said, fuck all that. I'm gonna create a program that I want to play in that feels fun. And it was an experiment. If it worked, it worked. And it's worked two times, and I'm in the middle of filling my third one right now. So.
Well, congratulations. That's exciting. Yeah. Do you have any other practices or things that you do to make sure that you stay out of your own way and can stay in your heart or your spirit and not get caught up in the head?
Yeah, I have a couple of them. One is I normally don't take any calls until after 10 o'clock. So I come into my office, which you can see is this very colorful space. And I just start the day slow and easy. And I sip my coffee and maybe I Facebook or listen to some music. And I usually do a little bit of journaling or art journaling or writing. Like I call them I am list, or my, instead of a to-do list, I make a to-feel list, like what I want to feel for the week and what I want to feel in my business. Because if I write the to-do, then I get in the how, and the how stops me. And then the other thing I do, especially as far as creating clients, is I got to be sure that I go and connect with nature. And I forget that sometime. And so I'll go and lay out in the backyard and literally just get grounded in the backyard and be in nature and kind of an awake meditation of just connecting with my clients, not even knowing who they are, but just focusing on my spirit, focusing on my heart, focusing on my light, and then seeing my light connect to theirs. So I don't have a face or a name with it yet, but I allow the connection to begin before the physical connection. And I call it calling them in. Like I'm just in a sacred way, I'm honoring those relationships from a spiritual place before they come to the physical realm. And that's been really fun because it doesn't necessarily take the effort out of creating clients, but it takes the striving, and it reminds me of my truth. So let's say, you know, and with these programs, like with this Wolf program, the dates are complicated. It's not to a pretty beach. It's to a cabin in the winter. It's traveling right after the new year, and it's longer and more expensive than what I've done before. And at the same time, there's people doing fabulous programs like Rich's program, and some of our people cross over. And so I've had a lot more no's than I've ever had in my life. And it just reminds me that there's not a number to hit. It's the right people show up. There's no convincing. There's literally a sacred contract in a spiritual realm that is just being called to activate now. And I realize I probably sound crazy, but that's how I roll.
Who is this nut job that I'm talking to right now?
Right.
No.
But that's really what allowing the spirit part to come into business and running business in a spiritual way, not a religious way. I don't really have a religion, but just tapping into my intuition and tapping into their intuition and connecting on a different level. But it also gives me a peace of mind, because when I stay in that heart space, I don't worry if a client says no, or somebody says no, or I don't worry if, you know, I've had a couple of $28,000 months, and then I'll have a $3,000 month, or I'll have a flat zero month. And I used to get worried about things like that. I don't worry anymore. You know, I can't, I guess I enrolled somebody in December that paid me for the Wolf. But, you know, November and December weren't great, but August was $30,000 and the next month was $15,000. And so when I'm from that place, you know, if I think about that in my head, then I can start wigging out. But if I drop back down into my heart, I know it's all taken care of. And my job is to do my art practices, do my spiritual practices, love on people, and listen for inspired action. What am I inspired to actually go and then do? But if I'm not inspired to take action, I will not force myself to do it.
Yeah, that's so great. And you dropped so many wisdom bombs there. I'm still building. The rubble is still over here. I'm creating something from it.
Listen, like that, man. There is no pause. No, I talk a lot. That's me.
Yeah, well, what I'm hearing in some sense is that you connect with what's most important to you, and that you make sure that you have a unique set of practices, and I almost want to dive deeper into your practice of going out into nature. And you said you call the client in there in some way. You start that connection before it ever exists. And while I want to honor that everyone has their own unique practice, and so for the people who are watching, for all of us to just honor where we are and what works for us, I am curious, because I have a sense that what you shared does resonate with a lot of the people watching. And if they wanted to deepen that practice of kind of calling this into existence before it's there, how do you go about that?
Jacob, it was so fun. I was on a call with some people that I was in a group with, and it was men and women. And my coach had me do this practice with these two men. And so, like, in this 10-minute period of time, and normally, like, I languish and lay in the yard and for, you know, a couple hours. And so I had 10 minutes to take these two guys through this process. And I really just used a visualization process. And so the idea of, you know, in my mind's eye, seeing my heart, and, you know, and even touching my heart, like anchoring and touching my heart. And in my mind, seeing my energy go towards my heart, like literally seeing it drop down out of my head and into my heart. Seeing my heart as a color, I tend to see a lot of color clearly, and allowing my heart to get warmer and brighter. And then seeing that energy, like, you know, this yellow gold energy go up and down my chakras, like, right? So up from my base of my spine, and I take them all through my chakras, and then they go out of my head. And as they go out of my head, it goes, I envision it going up into above where I am, out of the Earth's orbit. And if I really need to draw a picture of this, but I had this image, like, so if you have a circle of the Earth, right, and this is 2D, and there's other people and their little light is going out, it's like there's these little arcs that connect, mm-hmm. You know, so I imagine my light going up, and I don't know where and anything like that, but I just trust that it's like a beacon going out. And this is all just a visualization. It's all made up. Nobody taught me this. It's just kind of what came up to my mind. And as that beacon goes out, it connects with others who are seeking. And so I will say Abraham Hicks, I've listened to a lot of their CDs for the last 10 years. And I love at the beginning of their CDs, it says, our intention is that this information gets to those who are looking for it. And frankly, that's my business plan. My intention is that my work finds those who are looking for it. And so I set that intention, and then I kind of raise my light on the, you know, spiritual light pole. And then I see the connections happening. And then as I come back down into my, not into my body, but I bring it back down to where I am, I ask spirit, is there any face or name, or is there somebody to reach out to? And sometimes there is. And so maybe I'll go and reach out to them. And then sometimes there's not. There's like, no, just wait. And it's uncanny how things come to me instead of me having to go out and find it. It's uncanny how when I release and surrender and relax, truly relax, and a lot of times I freak out before I relax. I'm not all nama fucking stay all the time.
All right, interview over. You're not nama fucking stay all the time. I can't do this anymore.
And, you know, so I start to get tense and I wig out, and then I get back and I remember, and then I go do something fun, and I come back and there's an email that says, I want to work with you. And then we have the call, and we have a couple hours together, and it's like magic. And it's like some woman, we moved to this town and I'm in London, right, with you and all these other people. And I get an email from a girl in Denton. I've just moved to Denton, Texas. I know no one in this town. I've done no advertising whatsoever. And this woman has applied for the second program that I did. And in my mind, I make up that people in Denton are poor. Like I've, you know, like it's a low income town. It's a whole other story. And so I'm talking to her. She enrolls in the program. She forks out the $9,000. And she says, now I got to tell you the truth. And I said, what do you mean? And she said, well, I got to tell you how I really found you. And And she said, so I was getting my haircut and my hairstylist said this hot new guy moved to town. And so we were stalking him on Facebook. And it was my husband, and my husband doesn't always wear a wedding ring, and he'd gone to get his hair cut by the same lady, and you know, the hairstylist is trying to set these two up because they're about the same age. And so she goes, so I go to Facebook, we're in the chair getting my hair done, me and the stylist are looking on Facebook, and then we're like, oh shit, he's married, let's look at his wife, because that's what chicks do. So they go and look at me, and I'm on Facebook with my face painted, and I had at the time was, you know, promoting my Condor program and doing whatever I do on Facebook. And she was like, forget him. I got to meet that woman. And she started scoping me out, and she applied, and she's one of my clients. And it's like, if the universe can bring me a client through someone trying to hit on my husband through Facebook and her stylist, they just show up, and to allow for that magic.
Allison, I've heard a lot of strategies for getting new clients. I gotta say, I've never heard having your husband go out there and kind of walk the town to bring some chicks back in.
He tried to take credit for it, and it's, I mean, he's cute, and but it's, you know, he didn't really do it, you know, but yeah, exactly, he tried to take credit. But I think what, Jacob, really what that is who are we to limit how the universe can meet our needs? Mm.
Right? So, like, so here's where I want to take it and ask you is, a lot of people watching might be more disconnected from their spirituality, maybe. And I'm wondering for you, you were working in a more traditional type of sales role, it seems like, and now you're like totally fucking you, namaste, and the whole you, and we feel it and we love it. And I'm wondering if you can speak to that point where, if there was a point, and if there was, if you can speak to it, where you really kind of let yourself out and into your business, and what maybe that inner voice or that critic was saying, or whatever that is, because for the people who are watching who want to go deeper in here, I want to meet their fear also and talk to that so that, you know, it's not just an inspiring conversation.
Yeah. My heart literally goes back to the pain of about 2010 and 11. And in my first 2 years at my company, I did really well. But I also was not the CEO of this international company's favorite person. Yet I worked directly for her, one of the offices that she owned. But I had made her millions of dollars. But she still, like, we just had this clash, and I knew it. And I like to be liked. I want to work where I'm liked. And everybody else loved me. The agents loved me. The staff loved me. But I just did not get along with this one person. And one day I finally quit and I left. You know, I said, I'm not doing this anymore. There was some words that were said, but I realized that I had been trying to get their approval. And the moment I gave myself my approval, I left. But I was scared, and I was newly married to my second husband, terrified of being left, terrified of going through another divorce. And my husband is a teacher on a teacher's salary. And I had always been, you know, in real estate and entrepreneur. So I'm used to up and down. And I grew up with that with family. And I didn't want to hurt my husband. He was not okay with me. He thought coaching was a pipe dream, and he used those words. And so here I am, like, screw you. I'm going to go on my own and risk taker, except for the love of my life. My brand new husband is going, holy shit, I need safety and security. Lady, we've moved up to your standard of living. I'm a poor single dad. You know, like, I had his stuff going on too. And so when I left, I started my own company. And like the second I told them I was going to go out on my own coaching, the international office called me back and hired me. And I knew in my heart that that wasn't my path, but my husband was like, you're stupid not to take it. And so I did. And I spent another 2 years working at the international level. And I lost myself, right? I was doing what I was supposed to do. I was making a lot of money. I was making a lot of impact. But I just began to itch, like something in me began to itch that, you know, I was being told to coach a certain way. I wasn't like something in me knew. I just had that knowing, right? And yet I'm making $250,000 a year. I'm like famous at this company and everybody loves me. but I'm working nonstop, and I'm also knowing that there's more to telling people how many calls did you make, how many listings did you take, and that's all that matters. And I was terrified, and I talked to my husband. I was so, at that time, I mean, we had both been left by our previous marriages. So there's this whole person, you know, I get that everybody says, oh, you just go out and start on your own and you just do it. And there's other stuff going on. And, and my husband wasn't in the personal growth. I'm the only person, like, that was the only person he'd met that worked for themselves. That's not his realm of people. And so I remember one day thinking, Bill should love me. Bill should trust me. And I did that whole Byron Katie stuff. And I was like, oh my God, I should love me. I should trust me. And if I trusted me, how would I behave differently? And I went to my husband and I said, this is the scariest day of my life, but it changed everything. And I remember he's 6'5". So I'm standing on the stairs and he's standing below me. So we're actually eye to eye. And I put my hand on his cheek and I said, I know that you need to feel safe with consistent income. But I just said, listen, I love you. And this is something I have to do. Like, it is in my bones. It is my spirit's path. It is. I know none of that makes sense to you, but for me to be me, and if you really love me, I need to be self-employed. And I realize that's scary. And if you can't handle it, then we can divorce. And I will never say a bad word about you. I will just honor that our paths are different. And I was scared to death that he was going to say, yes, you got to leave. I really was. But I knew that I had to choose me. And not in a selfish way, but like, why be married if I'm not being me? And so, and he was like, okay. He just was weird. It was really calm. And he just said, okay. And I turned around and I went back upstairs and I was like, holy shit. And it was like, because I asked him, because I trusted me. And then I, in that slow and gentle way, said, I need you to trust me. Otherwise, I'm not being me in our marriage. He got it, right? Like, that's why I married him. He got it. And, you know, now 5 years later, he's my biggest fan. He is just amazed at, you know, he's had experience. But it was scary as all get out. And we, you know, he was great. He helped me budget. He's so good with money. For somebody who as a teacher hasn't made a lot, he's very prosperous. And he was so good at helping me budget and pay off my debt. And you know, he became an advocate, not so much for my business on the outside, but on the inside. And so instead of having that conversation with the people in your life who don't necessarily agree was a huge part of it. And even to this day, he does, you know, he's so supportive when I travel or I'm kind of getting off topic, but that whole, you know, I get that it can be scary. And I just started building and I worked with him, you know, together with the people in my life, you know, he wasn't real cool about me. This is funny. He wasn't real cool about me. You know, I'd cleared off some debt. I sold a house that, you know, I sold our house back in Austin that we were going to move to. And I cleared off debt so that we would be able to pay our bills without having to, you know, where I could have hardly any income when I was used to making, you know, $20,000 a month. And I bought a life insurance policy and I set my business up in an LLC and I bought a life insurance policy for $37 a month. It's not tons, but it covers any of my business debt. I keep all my debt off of I don't have any personal debt, but my debt is in my business name. So I also set up security and protection for him for $37 a month, peace of mind, right? So that he was okay. And I told, you know, he doesn't look at the numbers of my business. He doesn't want to know because that wigs him out, but he just says, I trust you. And we figured out a way to make it happen instead of saying, this is not going to happen.
Yeah. So cool. Thank you for sharing. And I think it for everyone, it comes to that needing to have that tough conversation with someone, needing to say, I have to choose me instead of you. And it can kind of be, or I need to choose me in order to really choose you, not to choose you and resent you or to feel forced into it. And whether it's with a husband, a wife, a parent, you know, a friend, whoever it is, it's easy to say we need to make our own approval more important than someone else's approval. But when we actually look at what is the action associated with that, sometimes it is having that heart pounding, you know, oh my God, is this going to be it? Am I going to get a divorce kind of conversation? And that was it for me. I had that with my dad. You know, it was really clear, like, Dad, my whole life, I admired you so much that I've been trying to become you, and it doesn't work. You know, I need to be my own person. And I can remember having that, you know, real sentimental, tear-jerking conversation. Cool. Well, that being said, we went way over in this awesome direction, and I'd love to bring us back in a little bit. One of the things that I'd love to learn more about is the group program that you run. If you call it that, I don't know what it's called, but it's the Women who Run with the Wolves Circle. And so you've done that program twice, and now you're running it a third time. Is that right?
They're similar, but they're not the same. They have different energies. So the first one was Tulum. We called it Sacred Sisters Circle, and they ended up having an animal medicine of a turtle. And if that's a whole other thing, you could have a whole 2-hour conversation on. But different animals have different spiritual wisdom for you in Native American tradition. And so they became the turtles. And then the second group is the condor, a really ugly bird, but it soars on, it doesn't use effort. It's a feminine energy. It's a feminine bird, whereas the eagle is masculine, and it soars on the winds that are already there. And so it can go longer and further because it finds flow. And then this group, I don't decide in my head. It's just something that kind of keeps coming up. And I was like, oh my God, the wolf and the women who run with the wolves. And there's a book by Clara
My girlfriend has read it, you know, like 3 months ago. I was seeing it everywhere. So when I saw you running that circle, I'm like, oh, yes, I get it.
Yes. So the idea is, and I think this is kind of been the theme of everybody I've worked with in the last, you know, from oil executives to a woman that ran a receptionist for 16 years at a chiropractor's office and a mom. And it's rediscovering who you were before you got lost. And the first two were subtle energies, but this next one, the wildness of women, like just to let our freak flag really fly. And there's something about gathering these women and doing, you know, 80% inner work and about 20% outer work, because some business consulting definitely goes on depending on what they're doing and wanting to create in their lives. It's like a disco ball though, right? So coaches are familiar with, like, we're often mirrors, but this is like a disco ball because there are mirrors reflecting in every different way. And then, so we start off with a retreat, and I try to create a true experience.
One second before we jump into that. Okay. For the person who's watching, who's like, oh my God, that's so awesome. Like, you're creating this group and it's so unique, right? Women who run with the wolves.
Right.
Was there any part of you that came up that said, how cool am I to create this retreat based on a book that I didn't even write? Was there any of that came up? Because just for the people who are watching, who might want to do something that unique and that kind of dear to their heart, but having some kind of inner dialogue about not really allowing themselves to do the thing that they really want to do. I'm wondering if that came up for you at all.
I think it came up the first time that when I did the Tulum, like this time last year, and I was doing the very first program. It was the very first time I had tried to do something this way. And now it's the only option. It's, what do I want to do? Like, I remember the first retreat I ever did, like 6 years ago, the whole retreat was built around a smoothie that I had at a retreat somewhere else. Like, it planted a seed, like, I'm going to have smoothies at my retreat. Cause I've been to so many corporate events where they give you that fucking continental nasty breakfast. I wanted smoothies, right? Like, and so I really started paying attention to what do I desire and trusting what I desired and what kind of group did I want to be a part of? And instead of waiting for somebody to offer it, I created it. And I also learned, Jacob, I've learned to trust myself that I have a wealth of resources and experience and knowledge that I don't have to plan down to the hilt. right? Like I don't have to, like, even when I do these groups, I can say, here's what I know. We're going to meet 3 times a month. We're going to meet together. We're going to have our Facebook group and we're going to see what happens organically. And I began to trust the organic nature. And so, yeah, at the first I was like, nobody's going to do this. Everybody's going to think I'm a freak. I can't believe it's so expensive. And you know what? I realized it can be polarizing. I've gotten emails from people that say, I cannot believe you're charging what you charge for that work because you can get it cheaper somewhere else. I just don't respond. You know, but then I have other women that are like, I don't have the money for this, but it's the thing I can't not do. They're not making a head decision about it. They're making a heart decision. They're making, you know, I talk with my clients, both men and women, and I say, does it make your balls tingle? Does it make your vagina tingle? Right? Like your body knows if this is for you. And a part of that is trusting. It's not about trusting what we should do. It's the same thing. It's about something inside my heart is wanting relationship with me. And I'm so used to the way the world has conditioned me, but I'm finally going to stand up and say, no, I'm going to follow the path with heart, but we don't know how to do it because we haven't been trained to do it. And so that's really, you know, for most of these people, it is an act of faith. It was an act of faith for me the first time. And this time, you know, when I'm sitting here and I'm hearing Wolf and I'm getting little pieces, Wolf, January, okay, Colorado, January 3rd or 4th. And I'm like, Spirit, wait a minute. That's like right after the holidays where plane tickets are expensive. And she says, I know, I don't want it to be easy for people to come. And by the way, I want it to be a full moon, right? And so it's like almost there's all these filters already set up in the organic creation that a lot of people are going to be eliminated. And this Wolf group, I really wanted at least 7. I only have 4 right now. I have 2 that are, you know, I shouldn't say that. I have 4, right? Like, and I'm used to having 7. And if I'm supposed to have 4, then it's 4. And if a couple more come in right under the wire, just trusting that it's supposed to be there. And yeah, at the beginning, I was terrified. And it was that thing I couldn't do. I had to shake the dust off my soul and do things my way. And I found after that first time that my clients loved it. They were hungry for it. They needed it. They needed somebody who was willing to do things differently. There was a gal, she built the Doodle Institute, and she's been a visual facilitator for the past 22 years and was shifting her business from traveling all the time because she's got 2 girls. And she wanted to call in a husband, and she did. And she moved her whole business online literally in the last 6 months. And she's having a baby with her new husband and moved. But she's so funny. So she comes to the retreat and she saw my agenda. And my agenda had arrivals, the time my shaman was going to come and do a ceremony, and departures, and nothing else on my agenda. And she was like, what are we going to be doing? And I said, I'm going to intuitively facilitate this weekend. There will be lots of free time. Well, you know, we'll have it. I just don't know when it will be. And afterwards, and to this day, you know, that was last February, she's like, I never thought that could have worked, because she comes from this logical place, but she's really learned to follow her ebbs and flows, to follow the energy instead of the time. And so that's, I a lot of my clients, Jacob, are the people that are scared to do that, and they're joining me to get the experience of that so that they can turn around and do something like that on their own. I'm just modeling and giving permission. That's all I do, is model and give permission and help people. I help facilitate that relationship with that part of them. You know, I ask my clients 2 questions. What does your inner whisper say? And what does your divine business manager say? And so it's not about my way is right, but I'm trying to get them, what is your inner wisdom? Like helping them build that relationship. And then what is your inner business wisdom? Because I do believe there's a divine business wisdom too. And it's so fun because the inner whisper and the divine business manager are the best coaches out there. And so that's when I learned to facilitate those relationships. These programs work and they're fun.
What's the distinction between those two? Because I've never heard it put like that before.
So I love to I guess in psychology, maybe people are trying to integrate all these different personalities. I like to go Sybil, like where I split them all up. And, you know, when I was talking earlier about leaving that company, I just knew, like, my inner voice, which I call my inner whisper, thanks to my friend Kayla. She first introduced me to that version. You know, you can call it a million things, but my inner whisper is the God inside of me. It's not the God with authority over me. It's the divine I am-ness that's connected to everything and that is so wise. And then I needed one that was also business savvy too, because it's like the divine whisper doesn't really care about business. She's just like Thich Nhat Hanh or Eckhart Tolle and just chill, right? She's like, oh, business, you know, whatever. And I'm like, no, listen, I still have a little bit of recovering overachiever in me. And so I kind of, in my mind, created this persona that is just the inner whisper, but she's got a really sexy Chanel suit on and high heels, and she's got an MBA and knows how to do Excel and all the business stuff too. And so I have the second answer specifically for inspired action around business, because yeah, all this fairy wings and rainbows and nama fucking stay is great, but like, you know, I still have to have a P&L, right? And we still have to create clients. And so, and there's still, how do you connect and create and do all those things? And so, and what maneuvers do the, just the business, divine business. I mean, I have a couple of blog posts on them, but you know, so I create those distinctions between those two personas. And for moms that have kids, it's like, what does your divine mother say? Or what does your divine spouse or partner say? Like, tap in for men, you know, like what is, it's the same thing. You know, I kind of use girl, I have a couple guy clients and, you know, I kind of modify them, you know, to make, I use their words, right? Like, I can't think of one right now, but you know, what is the divine boyfriend in me? Like, how would that person respond when my girlfriend's upset? Or the divine healthy self? I have been shut off to the divine healthy self. But like the one about the physicality and eating and exercise and like just kind of narrowing the focus of that conversation, because on a broad spiritual level, then we get to just breathe. And sometimes just breathe is really comforting, but sometimes it's like, fuck you, I'm breathing. What do I need to do?
Yeah, totally.
that's where I bring in, like, it's my own little team of spiritual consultants.
Yeah. That's so great. Well, so cool. So take us back to the Wolves program or the Circle program. So do you, one is, I love that your kind of model is to give people permission and to exemplify the possibility. And my view on it is that one of the most powerful experiences of coaching is bringing someone into a new reality. And the easiest way to do that is to spend time with someone in a new reality. So you're that person for your clients. I'm that person. I did my first retreat in Bali. We had 18 people come. I'd never done a retreat before. I had never been to a retreat before, which apparently is like rule number one from what I'm hearing. If you want to create a retreat, go to a retreat, but I didn't get that memo. So, I enrolled it and I didn't know what it was. You know, I had 18 people coming and to me that was, I had the intentions behind it. And from those intentions and a good group of qualified people who were very carefully selected, from that, it was me modeling that you don't need to know how it's all going to work out in order to follow your heart and do the thing that you most want to do. And I could have showed up and said that to them, but to actually step into the reality of me creating this as we went along was the lesson in itself. That's what I think you're speaking to. When you go about creating the actual experience of the retreat or the program, let's say, because it's not, in your case, it's not just a retreat here. How do you go about figuring out what you want to include in it? I know there's so much that is uncertainty and that you create from the spot, but is it getting clear on intentions? How do you go about it?
It goes back to that to feel list. What do I want to feel? What do I want them to feel? And one of the first things I really always want my clients to feel is prosperity and abundance. And I did learn this from one of my old mentors. I remember we used to have these, you know, our conferences at these super sexy hotels. And I was like, oh, this is the nicest hotel I ever stayed in. And she said, I want you to I want you to this to be normal for you. And mm-hmm. I loved it because a lot of times people are so on a budget and we stay cheap and we do whatever. And so I really want to up level and provide. And it cost me a lot of money. I mean, this Wolf House is $800 a night. Yeah. You know, this is the most expensive one. But I wanted a certain feel. I wanted it to feel like a cabin that you see on some TV show where most people are going in my fantasies, right? And like, I literally want to take this quintessential wintry cabin feeling. And I've hired a personal chef to come in and I've talked to her about, you know, what I want us to be eating. And I want some of the quintessential cozy experiences. I want to kind of fulfill some of those fantasies and show that they can be a version of real life. We're going to go visit with the wolves and spend a morning. I contacted a nonprofit wolf sanctuary and we're going to go spend some time with the wolves. And I don't know what would happen, but I know the wolves will teach my clients. And so I really just pay attention to the essences. Then I've also learned from experience that I need downtime. I don't do this. I'm an introvert, believe it or not. And so I need a nap every day and I need to be able to go into my little cave. And so I create these pockets of free time. Like you can take a nap, you can go into town, you can, and the women have told me that the in-between times are some of the most powerful because right there having deeper conversations, you know, a lot of times we go to these events and we have 10 minutes out break and then we go and drink with everybody. But these people are like having these really deep conversations and some of the magic is made in the in-between moments. And so for me to let my ego go and let something magical happen on the retreat while I'm taking a nap. And every time I pull out, something magical happens. And it's so nice to give that to them.
Do you spend much time creating the container? Because I'm interested in the difference between the one-on-one coaching and for those of us who are watching who are looking to do our first group or our first in-person thing, I'm wondering what we need to know about doing something in-person, in-group. What comes up for you? What was new that you learned in order to best facilitate that?
I do. It's not really any different than I do with a small group on. And I've been facilitating groups for years, so I got to really think about this because even when I was at this real estate company, the way I would facilitate groups, even when I'm speaking, when I get a public speaking gig, I'm facilitating a group. You know, I don't necessarily bring up people and coach them like Rich does, but I get down and use my intuition and I touch people and I see people. So in these smaller groups, I do what's called circle time, right? And I literally just get the energy gets passed on. And I'm trying to think if there's like any setup for, you know, no code. I don't really worry about I guess we kind of do a little bit of agreements and expectations, but in a little bit more feminine way.
What does that sound like?
Well, nobody really needs to be fixed, right? We're here to just hold space for each other. That you're free to share and everybody's just going to witness you. And I think, you know, you talked about these filters. Oh, you didn't use the word filters, but like you're 18 people in Bali, right? Like there's a lot of hoops they got to jump through, including the price and the personality, like the filter, all the filters, all of a sudden, I don't have to explain to these quality of people. They are respectful of each other. They're not trying to fix each other. Some of them are coaches, some of them are not. And a lot of times, frankly, I'm watching like on Facebook, you know, there's some hard stuff going on with some of my clients. And I just sit back and I watch and they're like girlfriends to each other. And one girl wrote this morning, she said, you know, all this other stuff. She said, the one thing I know is I'm not alone. And to be able to give that gift, and I know a lot of people have friends and we have friends, but these are not the things we talk about on a daily basis. And so Danielle Baird, and she's given me permission to talk about anything that works with her, but you know, she is on Rich's team and she's been in two of these groups. I've had two clients who've re-signed up. And she said, I never thought I could have sisters before. And so the combination of somebody that I could laugh and be silly and goofy with, or that I could do work and back end logistical stuff, but that I could also go to that deep soulful place with. And so drawing, allowing for all three of those categories of the human being to come forward in the container, and even allowing for, you know, sometimes in the coaching world, we are so like, don't be a victim. And I'm going through grief right now. My dog died 3 days ago. And I've been on Facebook, I've been actually processing out loud grief, which I'm terrified to do because people say, oh, I'm so sorry. And then you go in your hole, and I've been actually sharing some of the thoughts, and I realize that these gals are doing the same thing. And instead of, and you know, if they're in a bad place, I let them be in a bad place. And we just say, I am here for you. I see you. And because you know, I mean, I can see your eyes. I don't know if you're tearing up, but I can see just the sensitivity that, you know what? I love being a coach. I love being positive. I am a glass half full person, but the reality is shadow comes in and shadow rocks our world, and that we need to have permission to be both shadow and light. And I'm watching these women. Some of them are really in shadow, and some of these mothers are watching their adult children go through the really hard times in their life. And then others are doing really well. And it's not a competition. It just is, right? It truly is this circle. The circle is a certain energy, and it is a container. It's just it's not a program. It's a container. It's an energy. And then even when it finishes, you know, we talk about the container, this form is changing. The relationships will continue, but the formality doesn't. And I'm watching that the past group, they still hang out. They still talk to each other. They still call each other. They still send unicorn pictures to each other when somebody's having a shitty day. You know, they have their own language and they have their own little things, right? Like people do. And it's so it does. It models a new way for them to be. And I think, you know, you ask, going back to facilitation, I remember the first retreat I did, man, I had that all blocked out and how I was going to facilitate it. And I used all my fancy master's facilitation skills and all this other stuff. And halfway through the retreat, literally in front of the whole group of people, I threw my plans up in the air and said, fuck this. They were like, thank God. And I trusted myself. And how do you build that? You screw up a million times. You do it well a million times. You just keep experimenting and playing. You show up, you listen between the lines, you feel the energy of the room. And those are not things that I can teach anybody, but they are things that you can just go out. I mean, you know how Bali fit. How did Bali feel? Like, were there times when it felt glorious and then times when it felt stifled? And, you know, and you just, you know, you get stuck or stifled, you say, okay, everybody, let's take a break.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the how to. It's just being in the moment.
Yeah. It was relating to the experience as it was happening, checking in. How are we feeling right now? Man, I can feel the energy is like this. Who feels this? Anyone else feel this? Creating it together. Did you have any specific thought when it came to closing the group, maybe a ritual or just something to help ground everyone and bring some closure to it and go back out into the post-group world?
That's the hardest part, because it's just hard. We've had informal second retreats with my first group. We'll probably do it with my second, where they're like, that's it, we're getting together again. And we just kind of go slumber party. But the first group, they came to my house, and we had I do lots of little made up rituals. I mean,
and this, hold on, this is a free thing that you're doing now. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of like everybody, like usually they came and stayed at my house. We're probably going to go stay at one girl's beach house, and everybody will just chip in for food. So it won't be the same, you know, there's no private chef, but it's like vacation with your girlfriends, but they create it, which is kind of cool because they want to have a physical closure, not just on the phone.
That's so cool.
And I haven't put it in there because then that would raise the price by another $4,000. And I just don't want to work that hard. And so, yeah, we have this, you know, I literally talk about how the container, and I set it up from the beginning. This is a container. It's XYZ months. And this is what we're going to do. The energy is going to go on beyond. But the format, you know, I explain it all. And then we do have a ceremony and we talk, you know, there's a lot of gratitude and a lot of thanks and a lot of final words. And I will say in the past, my clients sometimes have felt like the shock of going back into the real world. Mm-hmm. And yet, and even the disappointment of, God, we don't have our calls. I just feel kind of hung out to dry. And it's not like I quit talking to my clients. I mean, I still am interacting in these Facebook groups and, you know, talking to people every once in a while. And that's also part of the coaching is the group holds you, but you are not the group. You are okay. Like, you know, I'm watching this one woman getting her footing after the group. And this was her first experience of coaching. So she dove in the motherfucking deep end, right? Like, and so it was kind of a shock. You know, I transition from coach all the time. I'm used to it. But sometimes these people don't know. And so, yeah, and I make myself available. And I don't just check out of the group. And some people have to do that. But because I work with so few people, and because I tend to become close with these people, I have enough bandwidth for that. Mm-hmm. I have plenty of bandwidth because of the way I've set it up. And I want to give all access to my clients within reason, like no yep. 2-8 calls unless somebody's dying. But I like knowing what's going on in their daily lives. I like seeing their Facebook. I like FaceTiming them at a random time of the day. I like that intimacy. I like the length, longer relationships. And one of my clients that's done the program twice, and she says she's not doing Wolf because they overlap too much, but she's doing the next one. She's been my client off and on for 7 years. Hmm. And she's also one of my best friends.
Yeah, that's incredible. Well, yeah. Well, Allison, thank you so much for sharing all that goodness. I appreciate it. And my final question to you is just kind of a curveball here, but what's the number one thing that you now know about coaching and your coaching business that you would tell to yourself, you know, 2 or 3 years ago?
That there's no right way to do it. What do you want to do? What would feel really yummy? And then let's figure out how to create what would feel really yummy instead of what you're supposed to do or what everybody else is doing. Yeah. And then to tail off that, stop comparing your insides to everybody else's outsides online. That is the kiss of death.
Mm, yeah. Yeah. Any best practices around that second one?
I use my inner whisper online. Yeah. Like, and I kind of have my inner Facebook monitor because most of my clients do come through Facebook. I love Facebook. I love it. It's a platform for me that I feel comfortable just living out loud. And so I listen and I feel like she'll be like, oh yeah, she won't say anything when it's good, but she'll start to go. It's like, she leans over my shoulder. She goes, Facebook's starting to get slimy. Like, you're getting slime on you. It's like, there's just like a little signal that goes off. So pay attention to your intuition. If your body feels light and good, the energy is vibing at a good place, and your body knows, your being knows when the energy drops and the vibes drop. Mm-hmm. And so I try to hear her, and every once in a while, she'll be like, she'll put something up there that'll really piss me off, and I slam my computer, and she's like, I told you, right? Like, I tried to gently tell you, time to back off, go for a walk, get off the computer, you know, that kind of stuff. So it's really listening to your intuition, but inviting your intuition in to what you see out there.
Got it.
Trusting your vibes.
Got it. So cool. Well, for the people who are watching who want to continue to engage in your work and just get to know you better, how can they go about doing that?
The best place is, I have a website, allisoncrow.com, allisoncrow.com. But the best place is to find me on Facebook and connect with my personal profile, which is Allison Crow Flanagan. That's my husband's last name. So we little shout out to him. But to find me on Facebook, because that is where you're going to see both my sunshine and my grief and my dogs and my coaching and my art. I mean, you're going to get the authentic Allison Crow on Facebook. Is the best place to connect with me. It's like coming over to my house.
Cool. Well, I feel like we already got some of that in your house today, in your office, and the authentic you. So thank you for taking the time, Allison.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
So what was your biggest takeaway from that interview? Shoot me a tweet at Jacob Sokol with the hashtag 4XCB, like 4x coaching business, and let me know. Now, if you're already running a successful coaching biz and want to take it to the next level, I'm hand-selecting 7 coaches to join me in an exotic mansion for a month to work side-by-side together as they quadruple their coaching business. The project's called the Quad Crib, and it's the only way to work with me one-on-one 2015. To apply, go to thequadcrib.com. That's the, Q-U-A-D, crib.com. All right, yo, talk soon. Peace.